while, you're probably wondering what that was all about. And it has to do with getting more seat posts out. And some questions. There's a hole in this frame. That's how corroded it is. But it's a Brodie. It's got a gator blade. And it's old. It's really rusty. Sorry for the jerky camera movement. Self-energizing brakes. You can see the Brodie noodle there. Anyways, I guess I just wanted to talk about some more of the posts that I've removed here. That's another one that turned out really well. This is not a Cove, although for some reason it was repainted. It's also a Brodie. We still haven't figured out which model. And I'm just, you can see the post there. I'm just gonna pull it out. So what I'm noticing is that Prestige frames, Tange Prestige, or the Dedichai Olmo that I worked on, as well as now this Rocky Mountain Summit, which I also managed to use the evaporust method to take the seat post out with. Unfortunately, there's no seat tube bolts that I could fill the seat tube through, so I had to remove the bottom bracket and the roller, but this post has successfully moved too after a night of sitting upside down with the evaporust and I guess the hydraulic pressure of all that volume of fluid wanting to, you know, escape out between here. And thankfully, as I mentioned, this one's moved. Where I'm stuck is with this Titan Half Trac elevated chainstay. And there's three True Temper bites, because I believe this is using True Temper tubing. I'm pretty sure it does. Yeah, it's right there. It's pretty obvious. It's just not in the typical location. And I've had to basically drill down, since the steel seat tube works well as a drill guide, with some oversized bits. And then I've also managed to cut kind of four slots in there, but this seat tube and whatever aluminum post originally was in here, and whatever alloy that they choose to use for True Temper. Yeah, I don't know, man. I mean, it could also be the welding here and here that, you know, caused the reaction to be more severe. But, you know, we have similar welding and brazing going on here. So any change in the metal structure or anything should be pretty similar. I mean, the welds aren't quite as nice as the Rocky, but nonetheless, that one's stuck, and we'll get it out. It's just going to take some time. We have to use some mechanical methods, and I do not want to damage the stickers by using a caustic soda, which will, you know, create a lot of heat and you know, damage the paint and the frame. So we're 4 inches down. I still got about 3 inches left to get through, which has been a bit of an ordeal, but slowly getting there with a reciprocating saw and a long bit. You can see where I've marked the extremities of the, how deep I should go here, and just very, very careful. Thankfully, the steel is a lot harder to cut into than the aluminum. So that's where I'm at with this. The evaporust method is working pretty well. Yeah, for how severe, I've never seen a frame with a hole in it. This is not par for the course from what I've experienced. Working really well. The gator blades are coming out nicely, and it will also work very well for the BRC. And then I'm also going to use the evaporust. Restored a Kuhara KZ1 a little while ago for a friend of mine, and the best way to get evaporust into these spots is just to dip the head tube straight in the evaporust, and it will get all the rust out of the pores there and allow you to clear coat or whatever you want to do on it. So yeah, I'm just gonna switch, see if we can keep working on this post and actually get it out of here. You know, you see the weeping of the evaporust between the seat tube and the seat post, so that's pretty much a sign that it's, you know, definitely ready to come out. So I'm going to set this up on the tripod and we'll keep going. Okay, my bench is on rollers, so all the vices bolts are loose. The bench itself moves because everything's rollered, because I have a bad back and I can't move things easily. This thankfully doesn't put a lot of strain on it. So yeah. So this is filled up to that hole with evapo rust, and it's been working since. I inserted it last night around 11 p.m. Filled it up, both of these. But this is the only kind of non-destructive way that I've been able to, like I said, get the posts out without snapping the head off or otherwise. You can see the surface area that was pitted to where it grabbed onto the synchros post and the many attempts that were tried mechanically before I tried this stuff. Yes, it's going to take a little bit of time to make it through. You can see a lot more weeping out here, which is great. There's a lot of corrosion on this frame that is hard to capture, and this is not a factory paint job either, just to also clarify. The art department did a much better job than this when they were painting frames. The other thing is this bonded aluminum. The aluminum post is a bonded head for the seat mounting hardware. And that's also started to turn, so you have to be delicate with these in comparison to the Rocky Mountain, which has basically a forged post or post head. It's homogeneous. It's one piece. That's the right term to use. That's a new one. I'll spare you guys this, but you get the idea of the process. This is where I'm at. I was unable to get the post out of the other Brodie. But I do have some more information to share. Here's the summit. Rocky Mountain Summit. I'll show you what it looks like in a catalog in a little bit, and some of the models that people confuse it with. The gentleman who owns these two bikes talked to Paul, and apparently this is a catalyst, and the Cove labeled one as a Climax. So still can't get over that hole. It's just nuts. Oh well, and how much corrosion there is on this thing. But anyways, yeah, I wanted to compare this frame here, which is built by Paul and or Mike Truelove, or one of the welders at Brodie back in the early 90s. It has to be after 1990 because it's got an 1 1/8 head tube on there. You look at the reinforcements, which is, there's not a lot of light there. There we go. Around the head tube to keep it from ovalizing. The Prestige tube set they likely used on this, with the ovalization of the seat tube. No S-bend stays yet. That happened after the Taiwanese production. And let's see, obviously Paul's going to use an unseamed bottom bracket, unlike the Specialized that I picked up a while ago, which also is a Prestige tube set, but because it's a production bike, they cheaped out and they put a seamed bottom bracket, which means you have a greater chance of dulling your facing and chasing tools if you are to restore the threads, which an unseamed bottom bracket or unseamed tube does not have the same problems. And thankfully, even though this is a production bike, it also maintained a non-seamed bottom bracket. And when it's seamed, it just means that it's a flat piece of steel that's rolled into a, you know, progressively through a die or mandrel, rolled into a tube shape and then welded along its length. So yeah, having a look at this, we've got Richie dropouts. I think we're spinner up front. No, they're not. They're Tange dropouts because it's a Tange fork there. guacamole fork. So they didn't cheap out on this. This nucleus, even though it's the cables are routed slightly differently, they've gone decided to go with top tube. They've got your even thicker reinforcement, so this frame is probably a little bit heavier. They've taken some weight out of the seat collar. The noodle's still present because this would have been pre V brakes. So yeah, slightly cheaper, or maybe they're the same. Let's have a look. So yeah, not as hollowed out, but that's okay. And yeah, about the same type of bosses for your cantilever V, or you know, whatever type of brake you end up throwing on there. What do we have for dropouts here? I don't see anything. It's kind of hard to see. There's something on there, I just can't see it unless I'm confusing the marks for the indentations of the quick release. Anyways, I probably am just spending too much time on that. Yeah, so that's kind of where we're at there, and I kind of wanted to go over some of the older Rocky Mountain. So I think this is 1991. Oh my god. Oh well. And a lot of people confuse the the Summit, the hardtail, with the elevated chainstay version. There it is, Summit RL. I don't see very many of those in the wild anymore. You do see wedges, which are an upmarket version of the I don't know the exact differences. I honestly didn't read this. I just looked at the pictures so that I could show you that. Those are all the specs there. And there's our Summit I have at the front of the car, which will get the Judy yanked off as well as the V-brakes eventually, and brought back to you know, better, more original condition. So that's it for the video. Sorry for the length again. I will get this out. It's moving more and more, but it's just going to take time, and I'd probably need another day or two of the evaporust reaction to get this thing where it needs to be. Yeah, thanks for watching, and if you feel like commenting or giving the video a like, I'm not going to say no, and I apologize in advance for my inability to sometimes engage. I get kind of stressed out and stuff, but I do appreciate and want to share not just the information, but some of the you know, just possessions that people in my orbit have that other people are curious about. And if you're restoring something, you know, it might be you know, helpful to see this, or whatever. Anyways, take care.